Guard my feet, Lord, while I run this race. Guard my feet, Lord, while I run this race. Guard my feet, Lord.
We have always been Presbyterians, so the moment we arrived in Seattle, that was our first question. Where is there a Presbyterian church?
And most of the members there, that was their history. They had always been in the Presbyterian church.
Sing a hope that I had the wings of a dove.
Because after the Civil War, the Presbyterian church all through the South had schools for black children.
I'd fly away and be at rest.
For 40 years, Grace Presbyterian Church welcomed African Americans to Seattle. Along with Mount Zion Baptist and First AME, Grace was at the heart of Seattle's Central District. Most Grace members, like 40 Ross and Gladys Edelton, migrated here from the South.
I think it was around 1948 when we joined Grace. It was a wonderful place to be. We had lots of programs. It was a very comfortable, safe environment, so to speak.
It was struggling, but they were faithful and they did a lot of things. You know, they had dinners and they had celebration and different groups going.
Daisy Tibbs Dawson, one of the first African-American women to attend the University of Washington, was a member and part-time parish worker at Grace Church. When the presbytery decided to close Grace in 1953, there was no warning for Pastor Ray Day, for Dawson, or for the congregation.
I was surprised. I didn't realize it was, you know, it was in the making. I don't think any of the members realized that, because the membership had grown, and we had about, I have pictures in there of the Sunday school, vacation Bible school, a lot of kids. And we had other activities going on, you know, the women group and the men. So I was surprised when they decided to close Grace.
The presbytery presented its decision as a positive step forward for black Presbyterians. But no one had asked the people of Grace, or the all-white Madrona Presbyterian Church, their new church home, what they thought.
They were just told, you will merge with Madrona, and your building will be sold, and the proceeds from your building will be used to renovate Madrona. They kind of faithfully went down to Madrona to find out they weren't welcome there. People didn't want them there. They were treated very badly.
We had our last service at the Old Grace on Easter Sunday in 1953. And the very next Sunday, my husband and I and some others came over to Madrona. And when we came, the first Sunday, it was a lot of people. The next Sunday, it was a few. To come here at Madrona, it's all white and we're mostly black. And when the blacks come in, the whites go. So, you know, so that's just about the way it happens. So,
what do you think on something like that? You wonder what in the world, you know, is that? But, you know, racism is... So I just thought it was because they didn't want to be with the black people.
Seattle Presbytery decided to close Grace, force integration with Madrona, and then use the money from the sale of Grace to build Mercer Island Presbyterian Church. If the story ended there, it would remain a sad chapter in Seattle church history, but it did not. These actions established the pattern of deceit, neglect, and dictatorial control that crippled Madrona for five decades.
Jesus, won't you help me?
Members endured pastors brought in by the presbytery that they didn't want, pastors who tried, behind their backs, to close the church, and one investigative commission after another.
That was the hardest thing to deal with. And the commissions, especially the last one, were probably the meanest people I've ever seen in my life. They were just cruel. They were terrible.
They just took all of the responsibility away from the members of the church, from the session, and they became the session. They were going to spend all the money we had. They were going to make the decision for a while. They really did. Up until the time that, I guess, somebody said we had enough and went to Senate and then the General Assembly, kind of brought a case against
me. I am one who always looks at the positive side of everything. I also believe that Presbytery, 98% and 99% white, did not have an understanding of black people. Therefore, the time of the commissions provided an opportunity for the larger body, the presbytery, to come to know that, gee, we, the black members, had something to offer.
And so we stayed and sort of dug in. And the Senate supported us. But the presbytery really wanted to close us down. And finally, it worked out.
If they'd walked away, nobody would have known the story. It would have disappeared in the dust of history, and we wouldn't have this opportunity to really see how racism works right under our own nose when we're participants in it, and we don't even know we're participants in it.
We always wanted to keep Madrona going, and it was a church that I always wanted to stay at, and so did my husband. You don't run away from a problem. You try to solve it if there's a way you can do it.
You can either let it destroy you, or you just keep going.
These elders agreed to tell the story of Grace and Madrona on camera with both hope and ambivalence.
I really have mixed emotions about it, because I am not sure what it would really accomplish. Because I can see that presbytery sitting and looking at this and say, oh, we weren't here.
A lot of times people don't realize that they're being racist when they do these things. So maybe they will, you know, something will come from, some good will come from it. At least the story will be told. Even the members of our church don't realize what all we've gone through.
The reason racism continues to have such power in this society is we're afraid to even point at it. We're afraid to name it. We're afraid to talk about it. The more we deny it, the more power it has. The more we fail to recognize it, the more it influences our decisions. So if we can learn to recognize it when we see it and name it when we see it, I think we can start to defeat it.
You know, racism is alive and well, and it still is today. And I don't know why people think that, you know, black folks are not equal.
For 50 years, Daisy Dawson, Gladys Edelton, and Thelma and Forty Ross have devoted their time, talent, money, and faith to ensure a future for Madrona Presbyterian Church. And that is still their goal, that through God's grace, the small, struggling, and now multi-ethnic church they call home will have a healthy future.
Every now and then we say, why is the Lord letting him still be here? And we want to, oh, he has a mission for us. You know, we have to fix it. But we have just stayed through it all. And in times been dreadful, and at times it's been wonderful.
The world's got to change. The world is changing. It's changing every day. And the church has to be willing to change with it.
We want to be known as people who extend our love, our arms around everybody.
It's a special kind of joy we have with one another. And when we worship together, it has a certain feeling to it, you know. Here we are before God. And for the moment we're safe. We may never put it in the words, but there, that's what's there.
Oh Lord, listen, if you can't say something good about someone, if you can't lend a helping hand to someone, if you can't bring joy to someone, do them a favor, just do them a favor, leave them alone, just leave them alone, leave them alone.
We're going to demo the inside of the building. We're going to take the wall out of the sanctuary into which we're going to create the choir loft, and then take up all the carpeting and knock out other walls, which we're going to rebuild later. Then on Saturday, we're going to take off all the shingles, put new shingles on. We're going to build the choir loft and create the two bathrooms on the inside in the walls that will create the new kitchen. And set up all the plumbing.
Oh, you can barely see through it.
For those bathrooms. And also for the kitchen itself. And we're going to do part of the painting this weekend. Take 6 days, and we'll have about 120 workers in total.
We're doing a pew forest.
So right now we are on schedule. The building trades showed up with all the people that they said they were going to have for us, and they're doing a great job.
This is Sheet Metal Workers, Local 66.
I'm with Local 131 downtown Seattle. I'm an apprentice carpenter.
I am a business rep for the International Union of Painters and Allied Trades. I've been a taper for about 27 years.
Arlington, Washington, out of Local 1144 out of Seattle.
Local 46 here.
Local 300.
International Union of Painters and Allied Trades, District Council 5.
I'm a taper. I'm with Local 64 in Tacoma.
It's a little bit wider than 1 foot 2, so we'll just hit that.
get that point right there.
Okay. It's almost unbelievable what has happened. Never dreamed that I'd see this. It's a blessing to not only this church, but to the whole community.
I've had many tears and sorrows. I've had questions for tomorrow. There have been times I didn't know right from wrong. But in every situation, God gave blessed consolation that my trials come to only make me strong. Through it all, through it all, I've learned.
It's been 50 years of stagnation in a cocoon, so the butterfly, I think, is about to come out. It's great.
I guarantee it.
It's amazing. What will happen to this building in 4 days?
1, 2, 3, move.
It's amazing.
Coming.
With members of the presbytery, the executive presbyter on the floor, drawing nails out of the floor, and members of Mercer Island and members of Madrona. It's just building new relationships. I think that's the way you deal with the ghosts of the past, is you deal with what's living.
Lord have mercy, it's fine. It's going to be beautiful when it's finished. But it's a lot of work right now.
I'm the secretary of the Building Trades Council, and I represent the 15 international construction unions in King County, and we have 27 affiliated unions and close to, if not over, 20,000 skilled construction workers in King County. You've got sheet metal workers in there, and electricians, plumbers and pipe fitters, carpenters. My job is herding tigers. And my dad got transferred to New Orleans, and I was 18 years old. I was a senior in high school. When we were transferred down there, my sister and I, who was younger than I were unable to register for school. This was in 1965. And the reason why we weren't able to register for school is because we didn't have a certified birth certificate showing that we were white. But that stayed with me my whole life.
It's truly miraculous.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
It really is.
Amazing.
Think about, even in this space, as many people as are in this room, giving up racism. I think that certainly God has been calling us for a very long time. We see this today in the entwined, intermingled histories of Madrona Presbyterian Church in Mercer Island Presbyterian Church. Even this very land that this church sits on was partially purchased by the money from the selling of the Grace Church of the African Americans. Salvation can be seen, a sign of God's kingdom, can be seen in the beginning relationship between Madrona and Mercer Island. Do not give up. Because Jesus overcame, you and I can overcome racism. This is no time for us to stop now in the 21st century. Racism did not get in our country and in our hearts overnight, and it will not go away overnight, but it will go away. You and I are beginning to decrease social distance. There is hope yet for us that we can be saved. Amen.
When the stars begin to fall, when the stars
this is a step, and a very good step, a great step. But we still have to keep working on the issues of reconciliation, and that's hard work.
It has been so much fun to get other people and the other trades. It's a beautiful building to start with, and then to make it a little bit nicer for someone else, that's pretty cool. And I think that's why we're all happy about doing it.
These people looked at us, Madrona, with the eyes of the heart. Mercer Island, the Seattle Presbytery, the building and trade unions, all of the people who helped us get to where we are on this Resurrection Sunday. Do you remember what it looked like the day they walked in here? Instead, they looked at Madrona with the eyes of the heart. Jesus, excellent.
Every brushstroke, every nail that was hammered, every stitch of carpet that was laid, was done so by hands guided by compassion, love, and a desire to help the community in which they live. This was not the Presbytery, Mercer Island Presbyterian Church. The sponsors of this were the people who voluntarily gave their time. There were 150 sponsors, and they all gave it from the heart.
We are here today because of the dedication and commitment of four members in particular who made the transition from Grace to Madrona and kept the congregation alive and stayed the course. Those are Elder Gladys Edelton, Elder Daisy Dawson, Deacon Thelma Ross, and Elder Forty Ross.
Everything is beautiful. It would be better to get a lot of new members in here and new programs and just have a real good time and place for everybody to come.
I really hope that Madrona and Mercer Island all will still work together. That's really my hope. And I'm going to sit back and enjoy all these many years.